Grace to you and peace. What a delight it is to see so many of you again this afternoon and evening. Hope you've had a wonderful afternoon and also enjoyed some good barbecue and good music on the lawn. A book signing will be held in the front lobby here in Watts Hall immediately following tonight's lecture. Several copies of Dr. Will Gaffney's books and those of Dr. Kimberly Russall's are available for purchase there. Our morning worship tomorrow at 11:45, note the time, 11:45 will occur here in Watts Chapel. Dr. Kimberly Russall will be preaching from Numbers 27 in a sermon entitled Squad Goals. Can't wait to hear that one. A community lunch will follow worship in Holderness Dining Room, and all are invited. Special reception will occur tomorrow morning at 10:30 to honor our 2022 Distinguished Alum, Mary Jane Winter, and our 2022 Black Alumni Association Trailblazer, Cheryl Blow McDowney. Hope you will come and join us in the Holderness Dining Room. We will reconvene tomorrow at 9 a.m. for a conversation with our Sprunt lecturer, Dr. Gafney, hosted by Dr. Sam Adams, Professor of Old Testament. An opportunity for question and answer will be included in this conversation, and it will occur in this room, not in Lake Chapel, here, so that we can do live streaming and those online can join in the conversation. It is now my pleasure to call on Melanie Jones, instructor of ethics, theology, and culture, and director of the Katie Geneva Cannon Center for Womanist Leadership at the Seminary, our host for tonight's lecture.
Thank you, Clay. Good evening and welcome to the third lecture of the 2022 Sprunt Lecture Series. Again, my name is Melanie Jones. I teach theology and ethics here on the Richmond campus and humbled to serve as the director of the Katie Geneva Cannon Center for Womanist Leadership. Our hymn for this evening is Blessed Jesus at Your Word, which is hymn number 395. Please stand as you are able.
Thank you.
God of our hearts, you yearn to be close to us, that we can know you in every breath, in every hope, and every relationship. Meet us here today. Teach us to recognize the covenant of justice, peace, and love that you have written on our hearts. So our desires become your desires, our work becomes your work, and our communities become spaces and places where you are sought and found. In the matters of the mind and the mundane, may we lean faithfully into the call to do justice and to love mercifully and to walk humbly with our God. Open our eyes so that we might see. Open our ears so that we might hear. Open our hearts so that we might receive. In your name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. It brings me great honor to introduce our lecturer this evening. Every seminarian has an aha moment. When the wheels began turning, the fire in your heart sets ablaze, and the reason why you are really here becomes ever so clear. My aha moment arrived exactly 11 years ago today, when I enrolled in a Maymester intensive course entitled Women Prophets, Women and Prophecy in the Hebrew Bible. Here is where I first learned of the Reverend Dr. Will Gafney through her words. Though there were numerous articles assigned, one text sparked my curiosity, Daughters of Miriam. Women prophets in ancient Israel. There I learned about King Lemuel's mother and the prophet of Noadia and even Israel's concubine, excuse me, Isaiah's concubine. There I consumed every page, line by line, as if it were my last supper. My final paper for the course, entitled Her Story Has Been Told, Do We Believe It? Tackling the Historicity of Women Prophets in the Hebrew Bible. Then I was struck with the embodiment of fortune tellers, oracles, and seers in public media that are generally female, like the fairy godmother in the classic folktale Cinderella and the oracle personified in the film The Matrix, and Voodoo seer in The Princess and the Frog. All of these women were prophetic intermediaries. If you were like me, maybe you scrolled on down to BET and saw Miss Cleo, the psychic superstar, who received her fame because many believed in her prophetic voice there, and she was able to receive major commercial time on prominent broadcast television networks. Here it seems that the societal representation of prophetic intermediaries in popular culture suggested a long-standing tradition of women occupying and even dominating such roles. Why then is it difficult to name and identify women prophets in the Hebrew Bible in our own churches? Perhaps such skepticism is linked to the habitual marginalization of women in the Hebrew Bible, the androcentric shaping of the Israelite cult in the biblical text, and the likewise questionable role of women leaders in the patriarchal society of ancient Israel. The fact that her story, the narratives of women prophets, has been preserved in the Hebrew Bible indeed affirms women prophets as verifiable in antiquity. A foundation then is established for women in leadership, and our current society must accept and fortify and even perpetuate such a profound legacy. I submitted that paper with certainty. Popular culture understood more about the prophetic power of the divine feminine than the religious spaces that I belong to that claim to be a part of a prophetic church tradition. You would never guess who my TA for the course, who graded that paper and signed with a casual nod, you should consider pursuing graduate studies. None other than the Reverend Dr. Kimberly D. Rousseau. As I walk, then, the halls of the Scholar Prophetarium, the School of the Prophets, with Gafney's writings in tow, a piercing inquiry and a nagging question developed then in my studies. What does it mean to be a prophetic voice in a Black woman's body? If I am honest, this is still my question now that I seek to learn more than a decade later. Fast forward to 2017, I was a bright-eyed graduate student just finishing her comps who arrived on the campus of Bright Divinity School. I knew of Dr. Gaffney's words, but here I would encounter her wonder. Yes, we had endless runs to Tex-Mex restaurants where we enjoyed margaritas from time to time and talked about all of the things. But what I remember most is our shared love for the wizardry of Black girl magic known as makeup. For we took endless trips to Sephora, piercing each of the lines, going down the Fenty counters, looking at all of the shades, and then I knew for sure Dr. Gafney was a wonder. For those who may be familiar, or those just joining us today, the Reverend Dr. Will Gafney is the Right Reverend Sam B. Husey Professor of Hebrew Bible at Bright Divinity School in Fort Worth, Texas. She is trained at Earlham College, at Howard University Divinity School, our shared alma mater, and even at Duke University. She is the author of Womanist Midrash, A Reintroduction to Women of the Torah and of the Throne, a commentary on Nahum, Habakkuk, and Zephaniah in the Wisdom series, Daughters of Miriam, Women Prophets in Ancient Israel, and co-editor of the People's Bible and the People's Companion to the Bible, author of A Women's Lectionary for the Whole Church, and translator of its biblical selections. She is currently writing a second volume of Womanist Midrash focusing on women in the prophets. An Episcopal priest, canonically resident in the Diocese of Pennsylvania and licensed in the Diocese of North Texas, and a former Army chaplain and congregational pastor in the AME Zion Church. I have said it before this morning, and I will say it again. I identify the Reverend Dr. Will Gafney, fifth of her name, as a womanist wading in the word, a priest of wonder, a fierce translator of sacred texts, which we have encountered in this lecture series, a goddess of interpretation, the queen of the Midrash, Miriam's daughter, and Katie Cannon's dream. Though the slate of womanist biblical scholars is ever growing, Dr. Gafney now stands at the height of womanist biblical studies and interpretive tradition and remains a first-rate biblical scholar in her own right. Dr. Gaffney's works and writings rise to the top of the widening catalog of womanist biblical scholarship, and if womanist wisdom were in flesh, there is no doubt that the Reverend Dr. Will Gafney would be her name. This Sprunt lecture series, Translation Matter, Who Translates God's Words and How, features four offerings. This evening's lecture is entitled A Womanist Lectionary for the Whole Church, Translating for Thirsty Ears and Hungry Eyes. Let's receive now the Reverend Dr. Will Gafney with a warm applause.
Thank you. Thank you so very much, Dr. Jones-elect. I am still waiting for you to email me that introductory and descriptive statement. I appreciate it so much, and I appreciate each and every one of you who has taken your time to be with us here in person, and those of you who are with us online. The language of feasting is often the language of the church. Welcome to the table. In my own tradition, we have feasts and fasts. We come to the Eucharistic feast. We feast on the word. There is the expectation in Black church culture that you go to church to be fed, to do the work you are called to do. But in conversations with others around some of those sacred tables, some of us found ourselves in the course of our years-long consumption of scriptural fare that we were going hungry. Hungry for stories about people like us, girls like us, women like us, non-binary folk like us. I began to quench my own hunger and thirst with the recipes I learned in divinity school and later graduate school. Careful, close reading of the biblical text, primarily in Hebrew, along with a decades-long practice of listening to the church, to the text in Hebrew, either at synagogue or on digital recordings. I'm hearing a kind of echoey thing happening. I don't know if you're hearing that. From the earliest days of my seminary formation, I was focused on the women prophets, a topic that would see me into and through a PhD program. I was at the Howard University School of Divinity, and my Hebrew Bible professor, the now sainted Jean Rice, captured my imagination on the very first day of class, and I went on to take Hebrew with him. And he was writing a commentary on 2 Kings, that I don't know that he ever finished. But he asked me to do library research on the prophet Huldah. Now, I knew Miriam, and I knew Deborah, and I was pretty sure there were some others, but I had never heard of Huldah. And at that point, I knew enough about the Hebrew Bible to know that the fact that Huldah said, "Ko amar Adonai, thus saith the Lord," meant that she couldn't be excluded from the roster of prophets the way I saw a male scholar saying, "Well, Miriam is just kind of an honorary title." The woman that Isaiah had a child with, not a concubine, not a secondary wife, just a baby mama. Someone argued, "Well, you know, she was Mrs. Isaiah, even though there's no marriage language there, and as much as I fuss about the German influence on biblical studies, an older German scholar, Jepson, said, "Now hold on now. We don't give any other wives of male characters their titles. That's just not how it works in Hebrew. So her prophethood is her own." I was like, okay. So I studied, Huldah gave the references to Dr. Rice, and I was entranced, and so I wrote a paper called "Huldah, A Woman and Her Word" for Dr. Alice Ogden Bellis, my other Hebrew Bible professor. And she said, "I think you should present this at the Regional Society of Biblical Literature." And I submitted it, and they turned me down. And I went back to her, and I said, I feel set up. She said, "Did you tell them you were my student?" I said, "No, I expected the paper to be accepted on its merits." She said, "Tell them you're my student." I wasn't too proud, so I did. And then when I was in that session, I listened to some of the foolishness that all of us know we have heard in academic conferences, and you turn this paper down, and you maybe they said they were someone else's student. But then I had a society paper. When it came time to apply to graduate school, we reshaped that paper, and it became my entrance writing sample. When I got to Duke, I had an advisor who had firm opinions and didn't want me to have firm opinions. And a couple of people said, women prophets, I don't know if that's enough for a dissertation. And one of those people was James Crenshaw. And I said, if I'm not mistaken, you wrote a dissertation on an entire word. Now, I have Miriam, Deborah, Huldah, Isaiah's baby mama, Noadiah, the women prophets in Ezekiel, and then, you know, and at that point we went through. So then that, of course, turned to the first book. So those of you in seminary and graduate school right now, don't give up on those papers that speak to your soul. So I was working in the Hebrew Bible, interested in women prophets, but also interested more broadly in women in the text, because that is what I was hungry for. And one of my advisor's projects I highly commend to you, a dictionary of women in scripture. No, women in scripture, a dictionary of named and unnamed women in the Hebrew Bible, Deuterocanonical text, and New Testament. The longest name ever. And what Dr. Myers does is list every female character in the three canons of scripture by name, alphabetically if they have a name, and by chapter and verse if they're mother of, sister of, daughter of. And she came to the conclusion that there are 1,426 individual person human names in the Hebrew Bible. I told you the first night, you need to talk to me or I'm not going to let you out. Of that 1,400, how many names do you think belong to women characters just in the Hebrew Bible? Women with names preserved in the text. 25? 50? A little louder, somebody. 365. 111. Roughly 9% of the named humans in the Hebrew Bible are female, women and girls. But 70% of the 205 women's names found in the entire collection of the scriptures are in the Hebrew Bible. So that 9% represents 70% when you put the two testaments together. And so I often do this, I'm not going to do this tonight, although Clay was anticipating. I ask groups that I work with, particularly in workshop formats, how many women can you name in the Hebrew Bible? What kind of numbers do you think you pull in? I'm hearing 20. 50? Well, you don't count Dr. Rassar in terms of this particular assignment. I have had lay people go up to 40. I was very impressed. So if we were to develop a women's lectionary, and there are 111 names and 52 Sundays a year, it is possible, should one choose, to preach on women every week of the year and then some. One of the things that Dr. Myers found, questions are a great gift to scholars. There is a gentleman who was on the cleaning staff in the graduate department of religion, and he taught Sunday school in his congregation, and he had the good sense to get himself first class secondary education by asking all the professors the things he needed to know to teach his class well. And the gentleman said, "I know that Mary is the most common woman's name in the New Testament. What's the most common woman's name in the Hebrew Bible?" And I'm imagining with my sanctified imagination that Dr. Myers crossed her eyes, because she tells that she had absolutely no idea, and I had no idea when she told the story. Do any of you, Dr. Russo, you can answer this one. The most common woman's name in the Hebrew Bible is Ma'aka, M-A-A-C-A-H. Not Mako who fixes your car, Ma'aka, M-A-A-C-A-H. And she said, there are more Ma'akot, that's the Hebrew plural, than there are Marys. But none of us knew. And we would not have known without this interested layman asking questions so he could be a better Sunday school teacher, because he didn't have a formal theological education, but he valued it enough to get it how he could. So I determined to write and preach and teach about these women, and thus my volume, Womanist Midrash, was born, offering leaders and hearers a reintroduction to the scriptures that they may have thought they knew through characters they might not have known, along with an emphasis on translation and what it reveals about the text behind the text that we might not know. And we explored that this morning. All along, I was sitting in churches listening to scripture readings, retranslating them in my head or in my mouth when reading and reciting aloud or preaching. I have been preparing my own translations from which to preach from the moment I learned enough Hebrew and taught myself enough Greek to do so. I have always loved languages. I was telling someone my family traveled Europe when I was a child, and so as a little kid I had enough of, you know, three or four European languages to ask for cookies and play football. I learned and forgot Spanish twice. I have an interesting relationship with the language. It's just a thing. French is really my proper second language that stuck, and sometimes I get stuck in it. So I do languages. I didn't appreciate it as a particular gift or calling. I just knew that was a thing. And I didn't have time to study Greek because there were other things I wanted to study. And it's more or less like Latin. I did Latin in high school. I'm not bragging, but I was a National Latin Merit Scholar. And I took the test cold because the nuns forgot and didn't schedule anybody, and they begged me to take it so the school would have representation. So yeah, the case system is the same. So I taught myself Greek, and I was almost out of coursework when somebody asked me, who did you take Greek with? At Howard. Now, when I did my papers in seminary and I did my papers in graduate school, as with all papers, I'd get corrections, I'd get marks, you know, diacritical's a little funny, but, you know, nothing serious. And so I told them, I taught myself. And those rascals made me take a Greek course. I'm like, you didn't even know I taught myself until you asked. So I was really cranky about that. So I got a Greek-Latin parallel Bible, and I just read Latin while they did Greek. So I've been translating for a long time, and I had had enough of being hungry and thirsty. I was looking at preaching texts on 16 October 2017, and I've got this tweet bookmarked. Looking at the Episcopal lectionary for the coming Sunday, and I despaired. I tweeted and Facebooked, what would it look like if women built a lectionary focusing on women's stories? And then 70 times 70 people implored me to prepare such a lectionary. It became my Louisville Scholar Research Program. I've just mangled the title of that program, but some of you will know the program in spite of that. So we're in a community where I don't have to go through the entirety of what a lectionary is. We'll do that when we look at the handouts. But what I did was selected new lessons. I didn't start with the Episcopal Lectionary or the RCL and then riff around them. I started with a blank computer screen, chose texts. My intent was, and fulfilled to some degree, to drive the lectionary from the Hebrew Bible text to show how they are a full and sufficient and complete testament of Scripture, neither old nor superseded. The challenge with that in a lectionary is that the lectionary is organized around the Christian calendar, so that must be determinative. So I held those two things together. And sometimes they worked well, and sometimes they were idiosyncratic. In other words, like every other lectionary, but with women. So I selected the lessons. My intention was to lightly massage the NRSV and just fix its most egregious problems. But I wish the people who knew me had told me, you're not going to be able to do that. You will not be satisfied with that. So in short order, I had a partner for the Psalms, didn't work out. We resolved it early enough that the project wasn't in peril. I wound up translating, and am translating, every single text in the lectionary, 4 to 5 lessons every Sunday for 4 lectionary volumes, 52 Sundays a year, every day of Holy Week, every day of Easter Week, all of the principal feasts and fasts on the Episcopal calendar, plus the Feast of the Ever-Blessed Virgin Mary and the Feast of Mary Magdalene. It made sense at the time. It stopped making sense when I had to translate the 157-verse Passion Gospel. And then I had to do it again for Good Friday from another gospel. So that is the project in a nutshell. I'd like to work with you on the handouts, but I want to say a little bit about how I did it. I built a Boolean search, which is what Google is. It's a Boolean search that you, so I use the Accordance Bible software, which I highly recommend. I actually endorse them on their website. And I took all the female terms I could think of, and I have, it's probably a 50-term search. So I developed a canon within a canon of women texts that would be my go-to. And then taking the season and the broader theme of the season, looked for texts starting with the Hebrew Bible, then the Psalm, and very soon I got into the pattern of, what if the woman in the Hebrew Bible text were praying this Psalm? Now, it's anachronistic, you know, they would be in different centuries, but just as a way of thinking about them. And then I would go to the Gospel, and then I'd roll my eyes and pick an epistle off the roulette wheel. You know, the epistles are where everything breaks down. But what happens is there are enough places where it says brothers that we know it means sisters and brothers. So I just, you know, wink and say that there's women in there somewhere. And so I selected these texts, and I'll use the example of the Great Vigil of Easter. The Great Vigil of Easter, in the Book of Common Prayer of the Episcopal Church, it's introduced by these words, let us tell of the saving acts of God. And so it starts with the creation story in Genesis. It goes to Sarah and Abraham. It goes to Exodus. And then it goes to these mighty heroes, Joshua, Samson, David, you know, whoever it is in there. Because I didn't look at it. Again, I did my own. So I took the creation story, and I changed the verses so that you actually had the creation of woman in the story, because that was not the case. Well, at that point, I did compare once I decided how I was going to do that. The Sarah and Abraham story, I made sure Hagar was there. The Exodus story, I made sure Miriam was there. It's almost like they just took the stories and cut out all the women. But then I said the saving acts of God. Well, we don't need to look at the men because we have Deborah. and we have Judith, and we have God saving Hagar, and we have Jehosheba saving the last Judahite king. So that if the point is to tell that God saves through the scriptures across the time, we can do that, and we just do it with women. So that's an example. That's not a season, but that's a particular set of readings. The other thing I do in the text is, I went over some translation principles with you. One of the most important ones is that God's name is not the Lord. The Lord is not actually in those texts. It is, if you will, a subscript of what to say instead of saying the divine name, which is unpronounceable. And Adonai, Lord, is not the only name. In other places in the text, it uses Elohim, God. And then there's a tradition in Judaism that you do Hashem, the name, and Hamakom, the place, as in the place where God is, HaKadosh, the Holy One. So there's already this pattern that you refer to God by other names. And so I drew a collection of titles, some of which I mentioned to you before, Fount of Creation, Womb of Life, Fire of Sinai. And I used those titles throughout. That was a principle that I didn't talk to you about before. So let's go ahead and take a look at your handout. So we're going to use Lent 5 as an example. I'm using Isaiah 40 for Lent 5 here. And it's one of the Daughter of Zion passages. And we talked before about Psalm 68, how it's really about women who proclaim good news. So I put those together. A woman of Jerusalem who proclaims good news, raise it, daughter, raise your voice, was the earlier line. Raise it, fear not, say to the cities of Judah. Many people understand this piece in Isaiah to be a woman prophet, because the same expression can be a woman from Judah as daughter Judah, or daughter Jerusalem, daughter Zion, the city configured as God's daughter. It goes both ways. Linking that with the psalm in which we have the tradition of the women who are proclaiming the good news, and then tying that to Romans 16 with the list of all of the women who do the work of the church. Prisca, and secondarily her husband Aquila, and Mary, and the apostle Junia, Tryphena and Tryphosa. I actually met a Tryphena. She's the checker at my Costco. And her twin sister is named Tryphosa. I was like, this is just awesome. Tie that to the Simon has the skin disease, and then Mary is there and anoints Jesus' feet. And that is, of course, one of the traditional readings of Lent. But you have it in the context of women doing the work of the church in Romans, women being proclaimers of good news in the Psalm and in Isaiah. So you have this idea of women being central to the God story, to the story of the church. So that's an example of how I frame them. And you can see that there's very crunchy textual notes there on translation. What am I doing? And why am I doing, with reference to the ancient text? So biblical scholars or other people who had that kind of seminary education will have that. And then a set of preaching prompts follow. So that's the structure. When I sat down to do this, I wanted to start strong. And so in year W is a standalone, so there are really two lectionaries. There is an ABC that follows the pattern of the church, where A is through the Gospel of Matthew, B that I'm writing now through the Gospel of Mark, C is through Luke, and the tradition has always been to just sprinkle some John around, you know, like Old Bay seasoning. I should add that Mark, I'm doing as much sequentially as possible. So the great irony is when the one biblical book I'm closest to translating in full, not counting Ruth and Jonah, because you do that when you teach Hebrew, will be Mark. It's not what I signed up for. So I said, I want to always teach Hebrew Bible, and again, teach it as a full and complete testimony of God's work in the world. And with Advent, the focus is we look at Christ's first Advent to help us prepare for his next Advent. So that's the theme and the rubric under which I was working, which is why you get the pre-Christmas stories. You get the Annunciation 9 months too late, but who's counting? So I said, let's take this Annunciation stuff. Because one thing that irks me is that things appear in the New Testament and people think they were invented there or invented by Jesus, or Jesus made this saying up, or this tradition is unique and Christian because they don't know the Hebrew Bible. So I said, well, let's take Annunciation and let our Hebrew Bible lessons be the Annunciations, plural. And so the first week of Advent is the Annunciation to Hagar. The second week of Advent is the Annunciation to Sarah. The third week of Advent is the Annunciation to Samson's mother. And then the fourth is the Annunciation to the Blessed Virgin. So that Annunciation is contextualized in the stories she would have known, right? So I take the Hagar story, which has been important to womanists, which is one of the reasons I wanted to begin with it. Sorry, I realize I'm dancing around and I've been backing away from the mic. I wanted to start with that. And the text that came to me next was the epistle. And the epistle was the kenosis passage in Philippians, where Christ thought it not robbery to take on the form of a slave. And everybody keeps going, humble himself to death, even death upon a cross. But I said, wait, stop. Takes on the form of a slave, like Hagar, who was raped by Abraham and forcibly impregnated, and in this world would no longer have the right over her body to do anything about it. Christ took the form of a person who is sold, trafficked, physically and sexually abused by Sarah. When the Genesis text describes how Sarah treated her, the NRSV wimps out and says, dealt with her harshly. The verb anah is the exact same verb that describes the Israelite tribulation at the hands of the Egyptians. So there is a framing here. What the Egyptians did to the Israelites, Sarah did to Hagar. In addition, anah is one of the primary verbs that communicates sexual violence. That conception was not consensual. Even if that term doesn't exist in their world and it's not a category they used, they still described Sarai's treatment of Hagar using a word that encoded physical and sexual violence. Christ took on the form of a person subject to wanton, indiscriminate physical and sexual violence. Now we can talk about the incarnation, right? And when I preached that sermon, I used the story of a woman whose legal name was Celia and was described in legal proceedings as Celia, comma, a slave. Some of you might know this particular slave narrative. She was a woman who was a girl when she was sold into slavery, and she was bought to be sexually exploited, and she was raped every day of her captivity, sometimes multiple times. At one point, she went to her trafficker's daughters and asked them if they could get their father to stop raping her while she was pregnant. They did not intervene. At one point, she fought. She struck him. He died. She was arrested. And in the, she actually got a lawyer who took her case seriously. Her case went up to the state Supreme Court, where it was found that she had no right over her body, even if she was in imminent danger of sexual assault. And so she was executed. So I use that story to tell the Hagar story, to set up the framework of what it means, that claim in Philippians that Jesus took on the form of a slave. So that's one way in which I use the lectionary to tell some stories. Another thing I do with the lectionary, and we're going to close on this, is I tell the story of the rape of Tamar. And then I pair it with Psalm 27, which sounds completely different in that context. So allow me. I can always spell Psalm if I don't have an audience listening to me. So what sets the psalm up is that after the assault, the text says that David did nothing, and I'm now here at the end, so the story has come out. And the king David heard all these things, and he became very angry. Yet he would not grieve the spirit of Amnon, his son, because he loved him, for he was his firstborn. That line, he loved him, for he was his firstborn, is one of the corrections that comes into translation of the Bible from the Dead Sea Scrolls. The NRSV is a post-Dead Sea Scroll Bible. There are some 80-plus corrections to the old RSV from the Dead Sea Scrolls, and Samuel is the most heavily corrected text. So the reading ends, because he loved him, for he was his firstborn. Now Absalom spoke neither ill nor well, for Absalom hated Amnon because of the deed he raped Tamar, his sister. So Psalm 27, you know, the Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? Listen, and we'll close with this reading. Hear Tamar pray this. The fire of Sinai is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The ark of safety is the strength of my life. Whom shall I dread? When evildoers advance against me to devour my flesh, my adversaries and my foes, they shall stumble and fall. If a battalion besieges me, my heart shall not fear, though war rise up against me. In this will I trust. One thing have I asked of the fount of life. That one thing will I seek, to live in the house of the womb of life all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the wellspring of life, and to inquire in her temple. She will shield me in her shelter when the day is evil. She will cover me under the cover of her tent. She will raise me high on a rock. Now my head is lifted up above my enemies all around me, and I will sacrifice in her tent joyful sacrifices. I will sing and make melody to the fount of justice. Hear my cry, faithful one, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. To you, my heart says, seek my face. Your face, just one, do I seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not send your slave away in anger. You have been my help. Do not abandon me. Do not forsake me. God of my salvation, if my mother and my father forsake me, the compassionate God will gather me in. If I but believe, I shall see the goodness of she who is faithful in the land of the living. Wait for the living God. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for God whose name is holy. Thank you.
The gift of the 2022 Sprunt Lectures is that we get the opportunity to encounter a wise sage. Thank you, Dr. Gafney, for your words this evening and for your time in this lecture. The Katy Geneva Cannon Center for Womanist Leadership every year identifies a scholar who embodies, personifies womanist wisdom, who lives fully into the call to do the work that their soul must have. This year, it is our distinguished honor and privilege to award the Womanist Wisdom Award to none other than the Reverend Dr. Will Gafney here, May 2022, on behalf of the Katy Geneva Cannon Center for Womanist Leadership, our staff, our constituents, and faculty, and the community of Union Presbyterian Seminary. Thank you so much for your work and your timeless gifts to our community. This is beautiful.
Thank you. Thank you to every single one of you that facilitated my visit, that has been so kind to me, that chauffeured me around, that fed me. And thank you for this beautiful award that will be displayed prominently on my desk. I'll scrape out a little. And I know you want to pack it.
Yes, yes, we will pack it. Since you are already standing, will you join me in our closing hymn, number 740, Lead Me, Guide Me.
Thank you. Yeah, but I mean, it had some of that same
Lutheran German chorale tune.
That, okay. The right key. I'm in the right flattery. Church.
That's right. Yes, you're in the right place. But much higher craft on his part.
But those Goldberg variations are awesome.
Yes, a legend himself. Yes, yes. Question: what's the story on the organ? The organ is the new one arrives August 15th.
The money's been raised.
The money's been raised. The contract's been signed. We've paid for it. It's so we will take this one out in the next month or so, it will be about the same footprint. It's not really a lot larger, but just much more versatile and made exactly for this space. It would just be really.
It is amazing whether you would a small organ if it's made for this space.
It is. It really is.
This came from another church. So
this came from Bedford Presbyterian back, I think, in the 1960s, and it's lived. It's an 1876 organ, so it's lived its life out. It is. We've squeezed every bit of life we could out of the.
I wonder how those old European organs out here. What do they use it for? A blower?
They were. You know, it was a. There was. I mean, this was hand pumped originally. There were giant bellows, and you would have people who would lift up. You would have a pair of them usually, I think, and lift up a giant bellow when it would. You know, it was under pressure, and it would go into a reservoir. It would let out the air slowly. You would bring up the second one to meet it, and hand pumped. This is a.